Okay, well, we have 6 o'clock straight up, so we'll get started. Thank you, everyone, for coming. We might have a few other people straggling in. How's this? We got
better.
All right. Okay. Yeah. I took my mask off to, I know so many people that have COVID that I actually sleep with my mask on in case I dream about it. It's either that or just have like a vaccine drip next to my bed that I just plug in every night. But anyway, one of our presenters also wasn't able to make it, Paige. We do have Cody and
Sophia.
Yes, from she's from Beyond Toxics, and he's the with the county climate resiliency. You're the strategist. The title of the strategist. So if you haven't signed in, that can go around. I also have a sign up for Florence locals that want to get together as a team for climate resiliency. And I'm not sure exactly what that's going to mean, but you'll hear from me when we're planning to do something. We're also asking people please wear masks. Beyond Toxics is requiring that, and especially now in light of one of their number testing positive. We do have masks here if you don't have one. So anyway, without any further ado, here's Cody Kleinsmith.
I haven't even said anything yet. I was unearned. Hi, everyone. So my name is Cody Kleinsmith. I'm in Lane County. I'm the climate resilience analyst. I work under Mark Nystrom, who some of you may be more familiar with, have been a little bit longer than I have. And today we are partnering with Beyond Toxics to do a little bit of strategizing for climate resilience. So we're going to start off here with a brief presentation, and then we're going to go into a workshop together where we're going to talk about strategies and all that sort of thing. I'm going to grab my agenda real quick. Just to make sure I don't forget. So, what we're going to do is we're going to have a brief, probably 15, 30 minutes at most of presentations and setting up the logistics here. And then we're going to have a nice set of 2 45-minute blocks where we're going to go into the workshop and actually talk about this local context and how we want to be strategizing for resilience here. Right off the bat here, what I want to do is just define climate resilience real quick, because it's kind of a buzzword. It's a very complex, big scope type of idea. So climate resilience is the ability for us to resist the impacts of climate change, to adapt to the impacts of climate change, and to recover faster from the impacts of climate change. So we've seen some of those impacts already here locally in Lane County. We're going to talk about those more in a minute here. But I just want to set the scene there for what is the general topic area we're talking about before we jump in. So, So, in our agenda here then, in this, Eric talked about, we're going to have some presentation up here at the front end. Then we're going to have our first half of our strategy development activity. In this activity, we're going to be thinking big picture about some local impacts and thinking about what strategies we would like to see. What are some potential strategies to address those impacts and build that idea of climate resiliency towards them? The second half of that strategy, which is going to be hopefully split equally down the middle in time, if we can manage that, is we're going to go through this matrix, which is just we're going to be looking and diving into some of those strategies that we really liked that we came up in the first half a little bit deeper. We're going to talk about the different ways they can be implemented, some key trade-offs or strategizations for actually getting those implemented down the road. After that, we're just going to have some real quick closing activity, next steps, and just share how this work is going to be moving forward from here. So, also, we're going to, again, continue setting context a little bit here with some objectives. So I'll read these out for you, but I encourage you to think a little bit deeper about what that means for you as we go into this activity. So top one here, address and prioritize strategies to avert risk and vulnerabilities to build natural, social, cultural and economic community systems. This is also to ensure socially equitable and technically sound climate actions. So things that hit on all of those five categories are home runs. Things that maybe hit on one can slow down the priorities. Next objective, create equitable and adaptive strategies to identify vulnerabilities while promoting co-benefits for coastal communities in Mankato. So again, talking about those co-benefits, talking about those five categories, seeing where they can intersect and we can address multiple with one strategy. And then the third thing here, identify opportunities for Lake County to support these strategies through federal, state, and private funding and the adoption of climate resilient community programs. So in just a second after this presentation, we'll talk a little bit about this partnership and why I from Lake County am here, why Beyond Toxics is here, and this will help flesh out this objective. So continuing here, we're talking about out here in the coast specifically. This is not a county-wide strategy workshop today. This one we're really focusing in on this region, this part of the county, because there are really some specific things that are happening out here that don't happen anywhere else. You all know this, there's an ocean right next door. That has a lot of impacts locally. So this first slide here, we're going to go through three sets of slides. This is looking at sea level specifically to talk about that, because that's one of the biggest impacts we're going to see. So we really wanted to highlight it. So at this top level here, we can see the region in general of the Siyus Law. And then we can also see zoomed in here, we got on the top there, Mapleton. That second one is where that big box in the middle there is zoomed in on. So just a section of Highway 26 between Mapleton and Florence. And then we've got Old Town Florence there on the bottom. So this is where we're at right now. This is what it looks like. And we're going to go forward here and look at Lake County coast and the sea level rise of a foot. So a little bit of foot of sea level rise of that. You can see there's those shaded in areas are places that can be inundated and flooded with that sea level rise of just a foot on average. So when we're looking at this, you can see a lot of things upstream, especially of the Siyus Law, down in that floodplain, in those estuary regions where right now it's a mix between soil and water and land and mud. And in the future, with just a foot of sea level rise, that area is going to be flooded completely. There's a lot of impacts that can come downstream from that. There's impacts to the fish habitat. There's impacts to other wildlife habitat. There's also impacts to the water tables. There's a lot of volcanic sponges out here that mean for people that are drawing well water or are reliant on different kind of foundation sets for their house, those can have impacts as salt water continues to move further inland and seep into those porous areas. Down in Old Town Florence, you can also see a little bit of flooding down there, but it's not quite as bad as we see upriver. As we continue to go, this 1 foot is a projection for about the 2050 time scale. As we continue to move forward to 2100, we can see up to 7 feet of flooding, and this is really dependent on emission scenarios in the future, so how much greenhouse gas reduction does the entire world do between now and 2100 can have impacts on this. But 7 feet is a very likely possible outcome if emissions aren't curbed. So here you can see a lot more impacts in Old Florence, the Old Town, seeing those sea levels rise. You can also continue to see impacts up the Siyus Law in those regions. So more and more areas becoming affected by sea level rise. The increased salinity of the water, the salt that's in there that people are drawing from, and that decrease in habitat for a lot of those species that are used to that freshwater environment. So continue to go through here, we want to set the scene of where all this kind of background work, these vulnerabilities that we're going to be talking about in our workshop come from. This partnership between Beyond Toxics and Lane County has been going on for quite a while now. And in 2021, one of the things that was conducted was a countywide vulnerability assessment. And this vulnerabilities were identified to some of the impacts of climate change, like that sea level rise example, but also a wide variety of ones. And they were identified with all of these kind of characteristics that you see here on the side. And we've talked a little bit about new objectives as well. From that vulnerability assessment, we have plucked out a set of those today that are most relevant to this coastal region that we're going to be using to talk about. This entire vulnerability assessment is available on the Beyond Toxics webpage, and we really encourage you to check it out. If you want to get a bigger scope of what is the entire list looking at, what are all the different vulnerabilities we have for those built systems, for those cultural systems. Maybe you're really interested in the natural systems. You can take a look and really dive into all of those. Yes, sir?
What was that called? It's the Lane, oh, it's, sorry, it's the Climate Change Vulnerability Assessment for Lane County, Oregon. And it's available on the Beyond Toxics website. Oh, you're okay? Okay. Yeah? So, we can also do some distribution and emails out. We can get in touch with Mark here and have him share some materials out as well for those that are interested. And if you're signing up on the Beyond Toxic sign-up sheet, you'll likely get an email as well. So, in that vulnerability assessment, this is what some of those sections look like. There's a lot of different categories. This example category here is focused on water infrastructure. And you can see that they are ranked by their potential impacts on the county. So this is talking about both their likelihood and the level of impact they would have if they occurred. So looking at this top line here, we have dams unable to hold back large storms. That has a high vulnerability risk rating because there's a lot of people downstream from those dams that could be impacted. Below that, we have the medium-high category, the medium category, and the medium-low category. Now, all of these can have very high impact levels to specific groups and specific communities and specific populations. So we don't want to call out the, sorry, I think it's the mask. Do you guys want me to take this off?
Yes. You don't want to, okay, because it goes in and out.
Right. That a little bit better?
Yeah.
Okay. So I will restart when I stop by here. This is about water infrastructure. We're talking about that. All these different risk categories. And what I was trying to say is just that there are these rankings that are established, but that does not necessarily mean that one of these is more impactful down the line in the future to specific communities or specific community members. When we're looking at the medium-low category, there's the toxic algal blooms threatening drinking water. That can have just as high as an impact of dams unable to hold back large storms if we don't prepare for them. So that's one of the reasons that we're still highlighting these today, is that they're still important, and still this proactive planning process that we're engaging with right now can help us prepare for those, even if they are the highest line categories.
And that's one of the really,
one of the really exciting things about this partnership and this climate resiliency work is we're adding this new lens that isn't often available to local governments or nonprofits generally are ahead of us, but local governments especially when thinking about disaster and emergency planning. So I'm really excited to have this lens. So I'm going to actually hold off on that slide here, and we're going to talk a little bit about the partnership that has brought us all here today. I'm going to talk a little bit about the Lane County side, and Lisa Arkin from Beyond Toxics is going to come up and talk a little bit about the Beyond Toxics side of this partnership. So, as I shared, this climate program at Lane County, is it cutting out? Hello? Okay.
Yeah.
The climate program at Lane County is a mighty team of two, but we're really excited about this work and putting it together because, as I shared, we have our emergency management department and we have a several hundred page natural hazard mitigation plan. But the climate considerations in that plan are not quite set up for success with the future climate change projections we're expected to see. So we're really supplementing that, adding to that, adding this plan that I will talk about in a minute, also adding this capacity to be able to carry out efforts like the ones that we're hopefully going to be talking about later today. So the Lane County team has been working really hard over the last 6 months or so to put together a countywide resilience plan. It's called our Community Climate Resilience Plan. And we're really close to getting that published. The first draft of that is hopefully going to be available by the end of this month on our website. And it's going to be talking about different strategies that Lane County is committing to either acting as the acting agency on or supporting other agencies in doing or bringing together a working group of agencies to move that work forward. There's also a lot of work coming up in different parts of Lane County as well beyond just the climate team around climate resilience. We're getting additional capacity across different departments like public health, emergency management, those areas that are also going to be helping move this work forward. So there's going to be a lot of places that this continues to happen. We're also really excited to keep working with Beyond Toxics to move some of these, especially the strategies that we may not have the jurisdiction to move forward, supporting them to help move that work forward instead. So let me invite Lisa up to just say a few words from the Beyond Toxics side of things about the partnership and their role and how we're going to continue to collaborate moving forward.
Thank you.
There you go.
grow a few inches.
Yeah.
Also, so you can see me. Oh, what a great group. Hi, I'm Lisa Argan. I'm the executive director of the Autopsies. And I'm really, I've been looking forward to this meeting for a number of weeks because it's so great to get out into community. And that's really what the Autopsies is all about. We're a grassroots environmental justice nonprofit. We're based both in Lane County with an office in downtown Eugene, but we also have an office in the Rogue Valley in the small town of Phoenix, just south of Medford. And we're doing a lot of climate work there as well. When I say a grassroots group, well, what does that mean? That means we're really connected to the communities. We often come to the coast. I can't even count how many presentations I've done up and down the coast at the request of communities who want to help work together to solve problems that are unique to their community. And that's why it's so important for a nonprofit like the Autopsies to be a liaison, a conduit between your community and Lane County government. As Cody said, at the moment, they have a mighty team of two, and they can't reach everybody. But we can, through our long history of working in Lane County with communities, really hear, listen, and dream with you to what kind of life you see ahead, not only for yourself, but for the next generations and the generations after that, and find a way to bring your hopes and dreams into something that we hope is not sterile, but something that could be as sterile as a county climate report, right? What could be more sterile than that? But, you know, we want to start with, as Cody outlined, what do communities feel are the vulnerabilities? What's the risk facing you? What's going to make it hard for you to have the lifestyle that your community needs and deserves? And then, once folks like you identify those vulnerabilities, such as in our vulnerability report, now we're at that stage of dreaming big. How are we going to solve those problems? How are we going to protect the coast? How are we going to make sure you have something as simple as, let's say, an air conditioner? Should there be increasing heat waves and things like that? Maybe you can't imagine that on the coast, but it could happen. Or what's going to happen if fires come to the west and all you have is the ocean facing you? Have we thought that through? Are there enough emergency alert systems? Those are the kind of things that we're interested in discussing with you. What does each community need? It could be something as simple but as important as growing food. What if there's worse supply chain holdups, whatever that means? I still haven't figured out what that means. But you know, what if we're having trouble getting food to our smaller rural communities? What can we do in advance to make sure communities are growing community gardens and that you have pollinators to make sure you're fruits and vegetables are viable and nutritious and healthy? Those are strategies that you can be thinking about. You don't have to be a climate expert. You don't have to be a technological expert. You can dream big and know what your community needs to survive as our world changes around us because of the impacts of climate. So there are no wrong answers in this workshop. We just really want to hear from you. And we're always available when you call us. You call the Autopsies, we will be there for you. I'll come out, staff will come out, we'll solve the problems together, and then we'll take the solutions from each community and bring them into policy, which is, you know, what has to happen. We have to have policy to back up the plans that we want to make. So thank you for being here tonight. I'll hand it back to Cody.
Well, I did have a question. Talking about how this gets to be policy, that's with the county commission eventually taking. But then you also have that task force that I serve on.
Speak up, Mike.
Oh, go on.
Just speak up. Just
a little loud.
Project.
Project. He's got to pick up the mic. I wanted to learn more about that relationship between what we're doing here today and how it gets to the county commission through that task force.
That's a brilliant question, and I apologize for not thinking about that. So I'm so glad you asked. So what's the structure here? Well, it's kind of a multi-tiered structure. It starts first, you know, starting with the most, you know, the foundation, the floorboards, that would be all of you. And then you have representatives like Mike on the Climate, Equity, and Resilience Task Force, and that's run by Beyond Toxics as a grassroots group. And we ask members from all over the county to serve on that with a diversity of age, race, experience, and geographic location. I think that's been happening over a year.
Maybe two.
And then that task force brings ideas from the community. So like this gathering today is a partnership with Lane County, but really is driven by the task force. And I really want to thank Mike and to thank Mark and others who have helped make this event tonight happen, because without the community, nothing happens. So we have the community, we have the task force that's staffed by people from Beyond Toxics. The task force also makes presentations to the Lane County Climate Advisory Committee. So that's a committee of members appointed by members of the board, the county commissioners. And they meet monthly. Those meetings are public. You are always welcome to Zoom in, call in, show up. I don't think they're showing up, actually, not yet. And give your comments, your opinions, and listen to what they do, and they have a website too. Then the Climate Action Committee synthesizes all the data we're bringing from communities and makes recommendations to the Board of County Commissioners. They're the ones that can say, do it, make it so. They can adopt policies, ordinances, resolutions. They can direct budgets in a certain way. Like if we need to get people in the valley who are low income, make sure they have air conditioners, or make sure people out on the coast have, rowboats, dinghies, in case you have to escape. They have budgets and they can make sure that the money's going to the appropriate places. So that's sort of the ladder there. And then of course there's county staff, and Cody and Mark, well, Cody's a fellow, right, who are also there, you know, like the glue that holds it all together. Because you need the staff to implement things. So I hope that explains it a little bit. And we're always happy to have people join the task force. Mike doesn't have to be the only one from the coast. So you can talk to Mike or to me about joining the task force, and that's really where all the effervescence happens, kind of like, you know, the champagne part. Okay? Thank you.
Okay. So what we're going to do from here is we're going to start moving and shifting our focus from this background, big picture stuff into now what are we going to specifically talk about today? How are we going to structure that conversation to make sure that it's, you know, it feeds into that process that Lisa was just talking about? So I'm going to talk a little bit about the first phase before we jump into the next slide, which talks about that second phase. First phase, what we're going to do is we're going to split up into two groups, because have shown up in such force today. And we'll count off in just a moment to separate into those two groups. And we're going to have one group over here with this easel and this group table, and then one group over there in the back with that easel and that group table. And we're going to talk about these vulnerabilities. I believe we have 5 for each group. We have 45, or around 45 minutes, might be a little bit less, to go through each of those and brainstorm a list of strategies that you all would like to see that address that vulnerability and build this idea of resilience towards it. From there, what we're going to do is, before we move on from one vulnerability to the next, we're all going to take a look at that list of strategies we have. We're going to think about, if I had to choose one or maybe two from this list that I really would like to see implemented fully, and I really want to explore what that implementation would look like, and we're going to rank them. We're each going to get a vote. We'll put a little dot by where everyone's voting on those. We'll keep track of that. We'll put that in our back pocket. Keep moving through the rest of the vulnerabilities. All five if we have time. If there's not time, and you guys just really like one vulnerability and you want to talk about it for longer, that's perfectly okay too. What we're going to do then is that's going to take the first chunk of our time. The second chunk of our time is where we're going to return to that ranking, and we're going to decide, okay, we have our first choice for this vulnerability of what a strategy looks like, and then we're going to take it through this matrix. So this matrix allows us to dive into those strategies in a little bit more detail. So on the top is just that vulnerability and that strategy that we've chosen, just as a reminder. From there is where we're going to start diving in deeper. We have co-benefits. So what other positive impacts does this have? Whether that's on climate resiliency, or maybe that's economic development. Maybe it's ecosystem health that's not related to climate resiliency. Maybe it's other things that are co-benefits. From there, then we're going to talk also about trade-offs as well. If we're devoting resources and time and energy towards this, are there trade-offs that come with it, inherent in that strategy and implementing? Are there things that are negative, you know, to groups, to resources, to populations that come with that strategy? The next is the responsible party. If we were to implement this strategy, who would be doing it? Would it be the county? Would it be a community organization like Beyond Toxics? Would it be a city like Florence? So all those different things. The responsible party. And this can be, it can be a larger list. It's not just one. It can be multiple people all pitching in and all joining hands to make that strategy happen. After that is equity considerations, both positive and negative, that this strategy has and impacts. And it says here, particularly for frontline communities, those communities that are most vulnerable to that vulnerability. And what is the way that this strategy can either be honed to really pay attention more to them, cater to their needs, or is this strategy one that might not be best for an equitable approach to building climate resilience? Those are all things that we want to be thinking about. And then the last one, this notes category, that's just our catch-all for if there's anything that doesn't fit here, but we think is worth mentioning. Maybe it's that there's an existing program that does something similar to this already, and we just want to jot that down as, yeah, let's make sure we link up with that organization that does that too. Okay. So this is our strategy matrix. That's going to take up the second half of the time. And hopefully, if we time it all right, we'll go through all five vulnerabilities in the first half, have a list of strategies for each, and then one strategy from each of those, we'll do this deeper dive in into the second half. So that is our last slide here. What we're going to do now is we're all going to count off by ones and twos. It may have been a while since we've done this. I know it's been a while since I've done that. So we're just going to do our best to make sure we're counting correctly. We're going to start in the back corner, just work our way and kind of snake around. Okay, so start way back there.
One.
Two.
One. Two.
One.
Two.
Three.
One.
Two.
One.
Two.
One.
Okay, the microphone is not working, so I'm just going to project real quick.
Good.
Thank you all so much for coming. On behalf of both Lane County and Beyond Toxic, we sincerely appreciate you spending 2 hours of your beautiful Thursday evening out here on the coast with us. I want to provide just a brief overview of kind of next steps of where this work is going on the Lane County side. And Lisa, if you want to provide anything from the Beyond Toxic side, feel free. On the Lane County side of things, as I said, we've got our phase 3 of the Climate Action Plan, so our Community Climate Resilience Plan. That plan is going to be public for its first review and be available for public comment by the end of this month. It'll be up on our website. If you are interested and not sure where to access it, I have some business cards here that they gave me that I never give out. One of them has my email address on it. You can email me. Don't call the phone number. I don't have access to that phone. So that's there. If you're not sure where to go, but you want to see that plan once it comes out in the next week and a half, week or so. Beyond that, after this, the Lane County is going to shift away from planning in their climate program and start doing implementation. Woo! So we've got 3 phases of a plan that we're going to really start focusing on getting some of that infrastructure bill money from the federal government, bringing that down here to Lane County through both Lane County, partner organizations like Beyond Toxics, and hopefully everyone else in the county too. So that's another route over there. So
are we going to get paid for this?
Am I getting paid for this?
Oh, are we going to get paid?
Are you going to get paid? But again, sincerely appreciate it, and thank you all so much. I'll be helping take stuff down, and if you want to have a quick chat afterwards too, more than happy to do so. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Lisa, thank you.